So, good morning, everybody, and welcome back. Hope you guys had a good week, and I hope that, you're fighting the good fight, you know, as they say. And I pray that things are going well for you guys at school and that you're enjoying being back with friends. And, you know, I mean, it's a weird time because I drove past a school yesterday and I saw on the fields all these, the kids were out during break and they'd drawn all these lines and they were, and these people had to sit in these boxes. It's like weird. I'm going like, wow, you know, what's going on in this? It's kind of crazy. Mad times we're living, but hey, there's growth to be found in these mad times, isn't it? So today we're going to carry on in the book of 1 John. And we're going to unpack verses 1 and 2 of chapter 2. Wow, we're going to get a long way through this one. Anyway, so let's open with a word of prayer and we'll come back. Father, we just thank you. We thank you for this time that we can spend together, even though we aren't together, Father. We thank you for the technology that you've helped us get. And we thank you, Father, that we are able to broadcast this to everybody so that even though we can't meet in church face to face, Father, we can still go through your word and study and learn and grow together, Father. And we thank you, Father, for all your blessings that you've poured us and we know poured out on us, Father. And we know also that right, everything happens for a purpose, that you can turn bad to good, Father, that you can change lives through this, Father, that you're uniting families, that you're bringing people together in ways that we've never experienced before, Father. And Father, humanity gets so busy with life and so busy with things that we tend to neglect those important things, our family, being together, growing together, understanding one another, caring for one another. And Father, we thank you for your word today. We thank you that your word will go out, your Holy Spirit will go out and prepare the soils of the hearts of all those whose lives you want to touch and impact on, Father. And we pray that your Holy Spirit will prepare their hearts and their minds to receive your word. Use me as your vessel, Father, to convey this word and let your Holy Spirit lead and guide me through this, Father. We thank you as we go through this that you will just provide us an infilling of the Holy Spirit, Father, that we can learn from your word not to sin, to grow, Father, in all that we do, and to resist the devil, that he might flee from us, Father, as your word says, and to grow and become better servants, better followers of Christ. And we thank you for this in Jesus' glorious name. Amen. Right, so let's go to a song and we'll come back to the teaching straight after that.
Hope is here, shout the news to everyone. It's a new day, peace has come. Jesus saves, mercy triumphs at the cross. Love has come to rescue us. Jesus saves. Hope is here, what a joyful noise we'll make as we join with heaven's song to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Can be remade. Jesus saves. Sing above the storms of life. Sing it through the darkest nights. Jesus saves. Free at last. What a joyful noise we'll make as we join with heaven's song. Saves, raise a shout to let all the world know that Jesus saves. We'll sing it out to let all the world know that Jesus. Jesus saves. Raise a shout to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Shout it out to let all the world know that Jesus saves.
So we're going to go to John 1, verse, or chapter 2, sorry, and we're going to read verse 1. Okay, so I'm going to get quite deep into this here because there's a lot to unpack in those first two verses, okay? So it says, "My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous." So now it says, "my children." So in the Greek, that means little ones. If we go back to the Greek and kind of, it just says newborn ones or little ones. So my children, and what it means is young people in Christ. So, you know, I mean, when I first became a newborn Christian, I was a child in Christ. I was still a baby and I was learning things. And if you guys have just been saved, or if you've just come to know the Lord, then you are children, besides the fact that you're small in stature still, but you are children in Christ. Okay. So we read that and it says, "my children, these things I write to you." So John is trying to emphasize, he's trying to teach us something. Okay. "These things I write to you." What is he trying to teach us? "So that we may not sin." Okay. Now, if we go back to John 1, verse 8, and we see and we read that, it says, prior to this chapter, he's now said before that, "if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us." Okay, now I think we unpacked that last week, and we said that people that come and say, "well, I'm sinless and I'm perfect," well, what are they? They're liars. Just the mere statement that they are sinless and perfect is a sin because they're lying. Okay. And then in chapter 2, John writes, he says, "these things I write to you so that you may not sin." Okay. He's saying that even though we do sin, we don't have to sin. And this is the process. This is the thing, is when the Holy Spirit comes and abides in our lives, okay, he convicts us of sin. He convicts us of the things that we're doing wrong. Okay. Before I became a Christian, I used to swear like a stormtrooper. When I became a Christian, it mattered. It was important to me that I didn't swear anymore. It was important that I started changing my behavior. Why? Because the Holy Spirit convicted me that my behavior was wrong. Okay? So it says, "these things I write to you so that you may not sin." Okay? So he's saying, even though we do sin, we can actually strive to not sin, okay? And we should do our best not to sin. And that's why when I prayed, I was saying, "Lord, we pray for an infilling of the Holy Spirit so that the Holy Spirit will lead us and guide us and teach us not to sin. Help us, you know, convict us in our hearts of the things that we are doing wrong." Sorry, voice. Okay. But the interesting thing is that if we do sin, if we look at, go back to John 1, chapter 1, sorry, verse 9, it says, and this is the most beautiful verse in the Bible, and I want to unpack it again. It says, "if we confess our sins, He, God, is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Okay, so we will sin. Fact, nobody is sinless. Not one perfect Christian on this earth. Everybody, if you mean you take Billy Graham, even a day before he died, he probably did something, thought something that was wrong. It was essentially sin in God's eyes. Okay, I mean, nobody can be perfect like Christ. Yet, if we confess our sins, whatever we do, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. That's powerful, guys. That really is. I mean, so, you know, often I get guys that come to me and they say, but I keep doing the same thing. And I say, yes, okay. But, you know, look at this verse in 1 John 1. Verse 9, it says, if we confess our sins, it's important to confess our sins, not in a Catholic church kind of concept, you know, and go and say, Father, forgive me for I've sinned. No, you get down on your knees before God and you say, Lord, I've sinned, forgive me. Or if you say a cuss word, right, you just say, oh, Lord, forgive me, I'm sorry, okay? And he is faithful and just to forgive you your sins and to cleanse you of that unrighteousness. Isn't that amazing? I mean, it's mind-blowing, you know. I mean, going back to the Greek alphabet, that teaching, those teachings that I posted for you guys a couple of weeks ago, I mean, it just continues to astound me how powerful the Word of God is and how many layers and how many depths there are to the Word of God. I mean, it's just amazing, right? Okay. Cool. So we carry on in verse 1. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. So John is breaking it down for us. He's saying, we do sin, but we don't have to sin. How don't we have to sin? Well, we are led and we're guided by the Holy Spirit. He leads and guides us so that we are convicted of the sin that we're doing and that we ask for forgiveness, okay, as we've seen in John 1 John 1, verse 9, right? But if we do sin, and it happens, and it's going to happen, because we saw that in verse 8, we do sin, okay? It says there, and if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. Now, that word advocate, we can break it down. In the Greek, it's called parakletos. Parakletos means somebody who advocates for, somebody who defends, somebody who has a depth of meaning. In the NIV, that one word, parakletos, is translated into 9 different words, okay? Just to say what the meaning of that one word is. Here, in the New King James Version, it's called the advocate. So what does an advocate do? He goes to court. He represents people. Usually in the old days, it used to be an advocate would represent the poor, the people who are struggling, you know, that sort of thing. And he would represent them for rights, for property rights, etc., etc. So what do we have here? We have an advocate, Jesus Christ, with the Father in heaven. You remember Jesus said, I go to be with my Father. I will sit. So Peter and Paul were busy fighting about who's the bigger of the two. And they were saying, listen, I want to sit at your right hand. And I want to, who will sit at your right hand? Because in Hebrew tradition, there's this thing where he who sits at the right hand is the trusted one. You see, in the Old Testament, you would see that the patriarch, the father of the family, in other words, Abraham, Isaac, or Jacob, would put his hand, his right hand, on the firstborn or on the son who was to be blessed and to receive the blessings and the promises, okay? He would always put his right hand on, and the left hand would be kind of for the second, okay? And we see for instance, Isaac, when Jacob swindled his brother Esau out of the birthright, and he went and Isaac put his right hand on Jacob's head. But when Jacob was about to die and Joseph brought his children, Joseph tried to put his right hand onto his firstborn son, but Jacob said to him no, and he put his right hand on the secondborn, and he passed the blessing on there. So who sits at the right hand? Jesus Christ sits at the right hand of the Father. And what does he do? It tells us here in verse one in the second part, it says, we have an advocate with the Father. Okay. Jesus Christ, the righteous one. Now, I want you to jump ahead in your Bible to Revelation 12, verse 10. Okay. 12, verse 10 in Revelation. This is an amazing book, guys. You know, I mean, a lot of churches don't teach this book. Revelation is incredible. And it can be summed up in one simple phrase: Jesus wins. That is the book of Revelation. Jesus wins. Okay. And if you think that the Bible isn't real, and we start going in depth into Revelation, and you start relating the things that are predicted in Revelation 2,000 years ago that are happening today, you're going to be blown away, I promise you. Okay, but anyway, I get off track there. So let's see what Revelation 12 verse 10. So then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven. Now remember, this is John. He's having visions. He's actually been transported into heaven, and he's busy seeing all of these things when he was in prison in Patmos. Okay, so he's now talking about, then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come, for the accuser of our brethren who accused them before our God day and night has been cast down. Okay, so what is this verse saying? It's saying that Jesus is there, present in heaven, but Satan, the accuser, okay, now salvation and the strength of the kingdom and the power of his Christ have come for the accuser of our brethren. So Satan is the accuser, and he stands before God. We see that in Job, Job verse 2, it's chapter 2, verses 2 to 16. If you read that, where Satan accuses Job of all sorts of things, and he keeps saying to God, Job is only a nice guy because, you know, he's got everything. If I take everything away from him, he's gonna curse you. And so the accuser stands before God day and night, accusing the brethren, you and I, okay, of our sin all the time. But God doesn't see our sin, because he looks down and he says, oh, that person believes in my son, the ultimate sacrifice, Jesus Christ. I don't see his sin. Okay, isn't that amazing? I mean, guys, you know, we need to understand something. The Bible, and I'm going to get there now, the Bible never contradicts itself, okay? And we're going to see that in verse 2, all right? Bible will never contradict itself. We can never build a whole doctrine of a church or anything like that on like one verse. We can't, because if one verse in the Bible contradicts, if we take it out of context, it contradicts the rest of the Bible, then we are twisting it to mean what we want it to mean. Okay. And remember, I keep saying this thing, it's not my opinion that saves, it's God's word. Okay. So it doesn't matter what I think. It doesn't matter how brilliant I think I am as a Bible student. It's not my opinion that is going to save people at the end of the day. It's God's word. And that's why I like teaching God's word. So we carry on with that portion in verse 1, where it says, and Christ, Jesus, the righteous, advocates for us next to the Father, right? So we know that Satan accuses us of all these things, and Jesus stands there. And but we see that in Romans 8, verse 34 as well. It says, if we go back to Romans 8, verse 34, who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes, and listen to this, intercession for us. Jesus intercedes for us. Jesus is praying for us. And we see that when Peter denied Jesus, and I realized the mistake I made. It was Peter and John who were busy arguing about who was the greater, okay? Sorry, we're going back earlier. But when Peter denied Jesus, Jesus turned around to him and said, no, you will deny me. You'll deny me three times, but don't worry, I'm praying for you. I'm praying that afterwards that you will lead the church, etc., okay? And so Jesus is praying for you and I as we speak. His job is not done. It's not over. He still prays for us. Jesus still intercedes for us, sitting next to the right hand of the Father. So his sacrifice hasn't only covered our sins when the accuser stands before God accusing us. He prays for us and intercedes for us. So it's going to be interesting when we die one day and we actually get to be before God, and we're going to be like, well, I wonder if the Lord will show us like all these places where he interceded for us, where he prayed for us when we were in sin, and where he prayed for us and brought us back. Isn't that amazing? I think it's mind-blowing to me. Anyway, let's go into verse 2 now. It says, and he himself, Jesus, is the propitiation for our sins. Now, I'm going to ask Colin is going to put the definition for the word propitiation. It's a big word, but it's essentially somebody who diverts the wrath of God by interceding for us. But it's a difficult word to explain. He diverts the wrath of God away from the sinner who justly deserves the wrath of God. Okay, and he intercedes for us and he prays for us. So that's the word propitiation. So it's a big word. He propitiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but also the whole world. Okay. Now I'm going to very quickly explain to you something here. This verse has led to many people. Remember, we spoke in Matthew 7 a couple of weeks ago. I was talking about the wide highway that leads to destruction and death, which is hell. And all these Christians, I go like that, Christians, okay, are walking down this highway rejoicing, Jesus, we love you, you know, and all that thing. And they think they're going to heaven, but they're not, you know. I mean, it's crazy because some people take this part of the Bible out of context completely, okay. So they're taking the last part of verse 2 and they're saying, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. So what they're saying, that is, no matter what, you are going to go to heaven. And they're using the scripture to describe it. And he himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. Okay. But remember something, that the Bible never contradicts itself. Never. Okay. So we can't take one verse out of the Bible and make it mean something else. The Bible will not contradict itself, okay? And we forget something that in John, I mean, if you just take John 3:16, I mean, I hadn't planned to talk about this, but let's go and find John 3:16. He gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life, okay? But let's take that even further. Let's go to John 3, verse 36, okay? It says, he who believes in the Son. Now listen to this. Who is the Son? The Son is Jesus. He who believes in the Son, you and I, okay, has everlasting life, okay? That is not a might have, maybe have, or whatever. It says has everlasting life. If you believe in the Son, Jesus Christ, you have everlasting life, okay? And he who does not believe in the Son shall not see life. Now, what's another word for life? Heaven. All right? Everlasting life, heaven. Right? But the wrath of God will abide in him. Wow. Those are staunch words, guys. We can't build an entire doctrine on just a half a scripture. And this is unfortunately what a lot of the wolves in sheep's clothing do. And this is why we have this broad highway that leads to destruction and this narrow, difficult path that leads to life. And few go by it, you know. Now, we need to kind of assess ourselves. We need to look at our lives. Now, if you consider that there's 8 billion people in the world today as we speak, the majority of those are going to hell. What are you doing? Are you going to choose to have life, eternal life, and eternity with God the Father? Or are you going to be dancing on the highway? You know? So let's read that verse 2 again. That to me is interesting. And I'm going to go back to John 3, verse 36 and read that again. Because I want that to sink in, guys. It says, and he himself is the propitiation. I mean, let's get that word right. For our sins. In other words, God, Jesus, intercedes for us, right? I've explained that. And not for ours only, but also for the whole world. So if the whole world turns around and receives Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, they, their sins too will be covered by the blood of Jesus Christ, the ultimate sacrifice. Now I'm going to go back to John 3:36 because this is important, guys. I need you to understand these things, okay? And I need this to sink into your heads, and that's why I repeat it, okay? He who believes in the Son has everlasting life. That's hopefully you and I. Hopefully all of you watching me believe in the Son, okay? And we have everlasting life. Isn't that amazing? And he who does not believe the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. You know? Guys, don't let people deceive you. This is the main message here today. Don't let people deceive you into believing something other than what the Word of God really says. Okay, this is why I reference things. I'll go to Revelations. I'll go back to Job. I'll go back to the Old Testament, New Testament, and I'll show you in three or four different scriptures that this one half a verse in John 2, 1 John 2, 2 cannot contradict the rest of the Bible. Okay, and that you must believe in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior in order to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Those are rough words, but I know you guys are champs anyway. So, and I know, and we pray that the blessing of God is upon you, and we pray that he will continue to convict you and help you to grow, okay? Convict your heart of your sin and all that sort of thing, that you will continue to grow and that you'll continue to grow and become better Christians, displaying the fruit of the Spirit, okay, the love, the patience, the kindness, the long-suffering, okay, the slow to anger. I need to learn that one, slow to anger, sometimes. Anyway, guys, have a blessed week. We'll see you next week, and it does get lighter as we go along, okay. You guys have a good week, and honor your mother and father, all right? Love you guys. Ciao.